Assalamualaikum and hi guys. So today, I would like to talk about kinematics of fluid motion. So in this lecture, we will discuss various aspects of fluid motion without being concerned with the actual forces necessary to produce the motion. Okay, because we will only consider the kinematics of the motion, in which the velocity and acceleration of the fluid and the description and visualization of its motion. Okay. So in general, fluid flows. Okay. So there is a net motion of fluid of the molecules. Okay. From one point in space to another point as a function of time. So as we have discussed in lecture 1, okay, I've mentioned about continuum concept. If you still remember, okay, in continuum concept, okay, by using the continuum concept, we assume that fluid contains fluid contains so many molecules, okay? So in order for us to analyze, okay, the motion of individual molecules, it is very unrealistic, or it's very 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 complex. So therefore we introduce or we employ the continuum concept. In continuum concept, fluids are considered to be made up of fluid particles that interact with each other and with its surrounding. So each particle contains numerous molecules. So we describe the flow of fluid in terms of the motion of fluid particles rather than the individual molecules, right? So this motion of fluid particles can be described in terms of velocity and acceleration of the fluid particles, all right? So in this lecture, we only consider the motion without a reference to the forces that cause the motion, because this one will be discussed later in the following chapters. Alright. So at any given instant in time, a description of any fluid property, such as its density, its pressure, its velocity, and its acceleration, may be given as a function of fluid location. Okay, so this representation of the fluid parameters as a function of its special coordinates, okay, special coordinates, is termed as field representation. Okay, not only special coordinates x, y, and z. Okay, normally, when we describe the field representation, we also include the function of time. Okay, t. Alright. So in here we have velocity field representation. So velocity is denoted by v. Okay, so velocity is the time derivative of position. Okay, r is position. Okay, so time derivative dr over dt is equal to velocity. Okay, so since velocity is a vector quantity, it has both magnitude and direction. So this one, this equation shows how to find the magnitude of the velocity. Alright. Okay. So in analyzing fluid flow, there are two approaches that you can use. One is called as Lagrangian, another one is called as Eulerian. So as you can see here, for Lagrangian approach, we follow the movement of individual fluid particle with time. So many particles are followed and interaction are considered. So this approach is called as control mass approach. So in most of the time, this approach is not not preferred because you have to follow individual fit particle, which is so many. So instead of using this, we use Eulerian approach. So in Eulerian approach, we focus on certain point in space and describe the motion of fluid particles that pass this point as time goes on. So this is the control volume, okay, this one. So the motion of fluid particles that pass this volume, okay, as time goes on, will be described. So this approach is called as control volume approach. Okay, so most of the time we use this because it is much easier compared to Lagrangian approach. Okay. So as I've mentioned that the fluid motion can be described in terms of its velocity and acceleration. Okay, so so as you can see here, okay, this is A. A is for acceleration, okay, stands for acceleration. So it is the time derivative of the velocity. Okay, so you can see here, just now the velocity has the function of special coordinates and also time. Okay, so here we have the special coordinates function, okay, x, y and z, okay, and this is the time function lah. So you make write as a time derivative of the velocity, then you get the acceleration. Alright, so in general, the material derivative for acceleration is written as dv over dt, the time function, u dv over dx, the x coordinate function, v dv over dy, y coordinate function, and w dv over dz, which is the z coordinate function. Okay, so in a short form, this long equation, okay, is written as capital dv over the capital dt. Alright, so this material derivative is used to describe time rates of change for a given particle, and it is very useful concept in analyzing various fluid parameters. Okay, not just acceleration. So this empty space you can actually change or replace with other fluid parameters, not just acceleration. Okay. All right. So this is the shorthand of the equation. Okay, so we move on to steady and unsteady flow. Okay, in analyzing the fluid motion, okay, we have to know whether the flow is steady or unsteady. So why? Because once you know that whether it's steady or unsteady, then you can choose which equation or which method that you want to use to analyze the fluid motion. So we have steady and unsteady flow. So what's the difference is that for a steady flow, the parameter does not change with time. Okay, the parameter does not change with time. So let's say if you draw a velocity here, u is velocity, velocity versus time graph, you get a straight line. Okay, straight horizontal line. So meaning that du over dt or any change in u with respect to time is equal to zero. Okay, however, if you get like this, okay, we have a not a constant line here, it's fluctuating. Okay, u versus time, okay, we see that there is a change in the parameter or in u with respect to time. So that means the flow is said to be unsteady. All right, unsteady. So in most cases, when you want to do the analysis, we have to assume that the flow is steady, eh? Because if we assume unsteady, then the analysis will be very complex. Alright. This is unsteady. This is steady. Right, next. Okay, in analyzing the fluid motion, okay, we also have to know the few terms. Okay, so one of the terms that shows or that visualize the flow, okay, or fluid is called as path line. Okay, another one is straight line, and another one is streamline. Okay, so in this slide it shows path line. So there are a few techniques that are available to describe the flow pattern. So this path line is one of the techniques. Okay, path lines are lines traced out by individual particles of fluid. So these can be observed by following the path of a marker as it moves in the fluid. So if you can see here, you put a dye or a marker in a flowing fluid. Okay, if you see a straight line like the dotted line that shows particle A and particle B, okay, so that dotted line is called as path line. Alright, okay, path line. So this is by using Lagrangian method or approach. Okay, you put a dye or a marker in a flowing fluid. Okay, you see a straight line, so that straight line is called as path line. If further markers were inserted at A and B and path line were coincide, okay, so the flow is called as steady. Okay, another flow pattern that you can use to describe the fluid motion is called as straight line. So straight line is a trace observed when a dye or smoke is continuously injected at a fixed point or points within a flow field. So if you can see here, we have an object or an obstructing the flow. Okay, so upstream you see a straight line, so the path line is straight. Okay, and once it hits the object, okay, so that is the point that I mentioned here, continuously injected at a fixed point. So this is the point. Okay, so it is injected at a point. So after this point, it is no longer a straight line. So that one, this trace, okay, is called as straight line. Okay, this one, straight line. Okay, alright, so here also a few examples of straight lines. Okay, so normally when we have an object that obstructing the flow, then you should have you can see the straight line. Alright, this is also by using Lagrangian approach. Okay, so another one is another one technique to observe the flow pattern. Okay, it's called as streamline. So streamlines are lines representing the direction of velocity throughout the flow field at any instant in time. Okay, so so you can see here, okay, the streamline is the tangent, okay, the tangent of the flow field. So basically, these streamlines are actually the lines that we draw. Okay, we assume that the line we assume that the flow has these lines. So for a steady flow, okay, so for a steady flow, the flows the each part each particle slides along its path, and its velocity vector is everywhere tangent to the path. Okay, tangent to the path. So the lines they are tangent to the velocity vectors throughout the flow field, called as streamlines. All right. So we can see here, if the streamline if the velocity changes with respect to space is zero, okay, the flow is said to be uniform. So this is uniform flow, this is uniform flow. So meaning that the velocity is constant. Okay, if you see here that the velocity changes with respect to the space is not zero, okay, the flow is said to be non-uniform. So you can see here, the velocity here should be higher than this, because okay, we put one here, we put here two. Okay, the velocity here should be higher than velocity here because it is much closer. Okay, here also much closer compared to here. So the velocity here should be higher than the outer velocity. All right, this is non-uniform flow. Okay. All right, this one you can read on your own. Okay, this is an example of simulation of streamline. All right. Other than that, when you want to analyze the fluid motion, you also have to know whether it's a real or ideal fluid. So, in reality, there's no ideal fluid. Okay, there's only real fluid. However, to make some to do the analysis, okay, and to make the analysis or the calculation possible, most of the time we have to assume ideal fluid. Okay, so what does it mean by ideal fluid? Ideal fluid is a fluid with no viscosity and incompressible. Okay, no viscosity, no friction. Okay, and incompressible density is constant. So fluid sleep at solid boundary. So velocity exists at the wall. In reality, it is not true. Okay, velocity is zero at the wall. Okay, it's supposed to be zero at the wall because of the no slip condition. So that's why, if you see here, the real fluid definition or explanation, we have no slip condition at wall, no tangential velocity at the wall, velocity zero. So boundary layer exists near the wall and velocity profile develop. Okay. We have velocity profile. Okay, so this is for real fluid. We have no slip condition at the wall. While for ideal fluid, the velocity is constant. Okay, so this is for normally for some analysis, that is that for us to do the calculation, okay, and to reduce the complexity of the analysis. Okay, and so this is for ideal fluid, A. For B is real fluid, and normally for real fluid, when you have an obstruction like this one, okay, for ideal fluid, it will go back to upstream and downstream. We have the same constant velocity, right? However, this is not true for real fluid. After you have a an obstruction here, okay, at this point. If you see the streak line here, there are wicks, okay? This is called wicks that appear or occur, produced, okay? After the obstruction. So this is called as zone of separation, okay? So of course, if you want to do any calculation here, it will be a more complex than ideal fluid. And another terms that you need to know when you analyze the fluid motion is lamina and turbulent flow. Lamina flow is steady, no mixing, smooth appearance. Flow of fluid with high viscosity, for example, like honey lubrication oil. Turbulent flow is flow with mixing action throughout the flow field with formation of eddies, characterized by statistical fluctuation about mean value. Okay, so you can see here, how do you know whether it's laminar or turbulent flow? You have to either see the pattern. If you see a straight line, if you see a straight line like this, okay, this is laminar flow, okay, most probably. And if you see, initially it's lamina, and after a few maybe a few centimeters, okay, in this experiment, or in reality maybe in a few meters, you see no pattern, not a straight line, okay, there's no pattern of the flow, okay, that means this is called as transition, transition from lamina to turbulent. But if you cannot see any pattern, okay, like here and both figures below, both pictures at the bottom, most probably it's a turbulent flow. Okay, other than that, that is for observation. Other than that, to determine whether it's lamina or turbulent flow, you can calculate or determine the Reynolds number. So Reynolds number is given by rho ud over mu or rho vd over mu. It's either u or velocity v. Rho vd over mu. Rho is the density, v is the velocity, or u, d is characteristic length. So if it's a pipe, so the characteristic length is diameter. If it's a square duct, the characteristic length is its length. Okay, its length. Alright. So mu is the dynamic viscosity. Alright. So the value for Reynolds number. If Reynolds number less than its critical value, then it's called as laminar flow, and if it's more than its critical value, then it's turbulent. So most of the time, the lamina is less than 2000, okay, and turbulent is more than 4000, okay. In between, it is a transition. All right. So when analyzing the fluid motion, we can also have a few dimensionality. It's the minimum number of space coordinates required for you to specify. So it's either you do one dimensional, okay, in one dimensional flow we have velocity profile that is uniform. That means we assume ideal fluid flow with the same velocity in pipe or duct. You can also do two-dimensional flow of real fluid in duct with real fluid lah, means you have the no slip condition, you have the velocity profile, okay, in pipes. And if you want to do 3-dimensional flow, the flow of real fluid in duct with x, y and z coordinates, okay. So this is an example of 1D, okay, 1D, 2D, okay, real fluid. Okay, and then we have 3D here. Okay. So last but not least is the frame of reference. The laws of mechanics are still applicable if the frame of reference is moving at a constant velocity in straight line. For example, the ship. It is easier to analyze the steady flow compared to unsteady flow. Sometimes convenient to change a frame of reference from a fixed coordinate to moving coordinates, relative frame. So for unsteady, we fix the control surface. So we only consider this area. Okay, outside this area, we don't consider in our analysis. Okay, all right. So this is for moving control surface. All right, but we assume a constant velocity. So that's it for lecture 4. Later we will discuss more in lecture 5, and in lecture 5 we have calculations. Thank you.